always go through that. And so always evaluate these lines when you're looking at your x-rays. Okay, now the classification that is most often followed is the Gartland type, where you have the type 1, which is undisplaced or minimally displaced. The type 2, where there is angulation but still contact. So that means usually their posterior periosteum is intact. And the type 3, which is completely displaced, where there is no cortical contact. Okay. And about 4% of these are flexion types, which there'll be anterior displacement. And sometimes, like I said, it's a little difficult to make out on the x-ray. Now, the type 1 can be sometimes missed. Okay. So you need to watch out carefully for things like the fat sign. So if you look at it, you can see the posterior fat sign, which is usually not seen. And here you can see that the posterior fat sign is normally not seen in a normal child. And if it is there, it should suggest that there's some hematrosis suggesting a fracture. And the anterior fat sign, which may be there even in a normal elbow, but there'll be some displacement of the anterior fat sign. So these are the two things you should look for. And the third thing which you should really watch out for carefully is if there is any medial impaction, okay? So this, so you can have some sort of comminution on the medial side with impaction, and the x-ray may look pretty normal on the lateral view, and just a little bit of impaction on the medial side, but those may end up in varus deformity, and the varus deformity is the one that is usually more of a problem because it is more of a cosmetic problem and people don't like it. So watch out for this medial impaction that you may have in what looks like a type 1 fracture. Now the type 2 fractures, again, the anterior humeral line will tell you that the capitellum is way behind it. So it's a posterior displacement. This is a minimally displaced fracture, but you can have more displacement, more angulation. And usually you will not miss this on x-rays, but you have to decide how you treat it. The type 3 are the completely displaced fractures. And here, watch out for any forearm or distal radius ulna fractures. This is often associated with some of these and may change your planning in terms to as to whether you're going to fix them or not fix them. So this is something that you should not miss. And as I mentioned, you should always look out for any nerve or vessel injury or compartment syndrome as well. More recently, a type 4 has been described where there is multi-directional instability. So the fracture is so displaced that you really don't have any periosteum intact on any side to help you reduce the fracture. So again, it may become more difficult to reduce these fractures, but today, usually, if they come early enough, you should be able to reduce them closed. Okay, so generally for the type 1 fractures, they don't need any manipulation. So usually you can splint them in a slab or put them in a cast. Obviously, you need to observe if there's any swelling, and swelling in these fractures are usually because of tight bandages, etc. Okay, in the minimally displaced fracture. Okay, so watch out for this. This looks innocuous, but if there's comminution on the medial side, it can lead to problems later. Type 2, you need to restore alignment and immobilize. Okay, now the issue is, do you fix these or not fix these? I think early on, the general trend was that you would not fix the type 2, you would reduce it, flex up the elbow to about 110 degrees, and then accept that. But the trend is towards reducing it and putting pins to fix it, because today with the modern techniques, you're able to do these fixations relatively safely without too much risk. So why take a chance of a fracture displacing on you? Also, another thing is that if you put in K-wires, then you don't need to flex up the elbow a lot. Okay, so you can keep that in a relatively semi-extended position and still maintain the position. So I think the trend is towards, even for these type 2 fractures, towards closed reduction and internal fixation. Of course, this is something you will discuss with the patient. Now, the type 3 fractures, I think, again, today, most of us would fix these. We would almost always try to do a closed reduction. There are some people who treat these in an external fixator, and it's popular in some parts of the world, and especially with some surgeons, and is another way of treating these. But the most common way of treating this is closed reduction, percutaneous pinning. Very rarely you would need open reduction. I think in the fresh cases, you rarely need open reduction, but you will every now and then come across a case which is really difficult to reduce. And sometimes, rather than struggling for hours to try and get a closed reduction, it makes sense to then do a gentle open reduction, get a nice reduction, and fix this with KY. So that's something based on your training, your experience, and how comfortable you are with doing them closed or open. So there are no fixed rules about that. But by and large, it's mostly closed reduction and percutaneous pinning of these fractures. Now, I think if you're doing a closed reduction, you need a child who's adequately under anesthesia with pain control so that you can do your manipulation without the child jumping around. I think there are people who used to do this without. I remember when I did my residency or my sort of internship and my first SHO job in orthopedics, we did some of these even without anesthesia. But I think in today's day and age, it's really not fair on the child. You need to be able to get the patient nicely calm. You need to give longitudinal traction, reduce the lateral sort of displacement, and then you tend to flex the elbow, okay? And get your proper reduction, okay? So the first is longitudinal traction to get the fracture out to length, and you should be prepared, you should be patient. You may have to give a couple of minutes of traction and wait for this to pop out into place. Check the medial lateral reduction. Once you've got it out to length, you get your medial lateral reduction, and then you tend to bend up the elbow. So that's what you correct the medial and lateral displacement depending on which way it is. And then you flex up the elbow with your thumb on the olecranon to push the fragment forward. Obviously, this isn't an extension type fracture, so that you get a good reduction. You would need to flex the elbow up quite a lot to get, and then check your lateral. So your OT setup becomes important. Sometimes when you rotate the arm to get a lateral, you may displace the fracture. So if that is happening, it's nice to have your C-arm set up in such a way that you can just rotate it and get a lateral as well. Once you put your wires, then you can rotate the arm without displacing the fracture. So you can check it once. If you find that it's not displaced on turning it around, that is okay. Otherwise, get it reduced and get a lateral view with the C-arm rotated without rotating the arm. And if that is okay, in the flexed position, so some people will tape up the arm in a flexed position so that it can't displace, or you have someone hold it and put in your wires. Usually it is the lateral wire first. Okay, of course, there are some contraindications for conservative treatment. And of course, if there's an open fracture or very unstable fracture, you would need to fix these fractures. If you have an ipsilateral forearm fracture or a distal radius fracture, it makes sense to fix them. It's not an absolute indication, but it makes sense to reduce it. And of course, if there's a lot of swelling, then managing it close to flex up the elbow adequately and keep it in that position becomes risky. So it makes sense to reduce it and then put your wires so that you can then semi-extend the elbow without losing your reduction. Okay, so I think so those are the pitfalls of closed manipulation and fixation without sort of not fixing these fractures, just closed manipulation and casting, is that you may not get an adequate position, and you may not, you may lose your position in follow-up and then fail to recognize it. So I think So even if it is grossly displaced, there are various techniques you can sort of milk out the... So whenever you have something like this, and I'll show, I think, the same case, a similar case later, where this fragment is really gone through the brachialis and very often is just under the skin and it may be stuck in the brachialis. So you need to milk out this fragment from the brachialis by gently sort of doing what we call the milking maneuver to get this fragment out of the brachialis before you can reduce the fracture. In a very unstable situation like this, you would put two lateral pins and maybe add a medial pin. But it's important to get your reduction right, both on your AP and lateral views. So this is the follow-up. You can see how well it's nicely reduced on the AP, and again on the lateral, you can see it's nicely reduced. The wires are crossed distal proximal to the fracture. Again, the follow-up showing a maintenance of the position and reduction. So this is what I was telling you about, this puckering sign. If your proximal fragment has gone through the brachialis, you'll get this puckering thing on the skin, and that will show up as this very displaced fracture, and you will need to do that milking maneuver to get it reduced. In this particular case, we used three lateral wires. Okay, so, and one of these wires will actually go through the olecranon fossa, so that it is what we call the four cortex wires. So the usual pin configurations that we use are, one is the crossed pin, which was the traditional way of fixing these fractures. But because of the incidence of ulnar nerve problems with the medial pin, some people have gone away from doing this medial pin. And the general trend is to put two lateral wires. And if you're putting two lateral wires, it's a good idea to keep them divergent. Okay, so that they are actually crossing outside the body and they go in different directions. And like I said, this wire will usually go through the olecranon fossa, so the cortices in both sides and across here. And because you take out this wire, when you take out the cast, these wires don't cause a problem with movement. Okay, so usually at 3 weeks, when you take off the cast, you can take off the wires in the OPD itself without anesthesia. And most children tolerate this without any problems. Okay, so make sure you get all these C-arm views in oblique views also to check. So don't just see AP lateral, check the oblique views, because that's what will tell you that there is no rotation of the fragments. Now, as I mentioned earlier, because the advantages of pinning, it allows you to extend the elbow and check the position, and it obviates the need for extreme positioning in the cast. So you can splint it in up to 50 to 45 degrees of flexion, okay, in slight extension, and this will reduce the pressures, reduce the risk of a lot of swelling happening and even compartment syndrome. Okay, now one important thing which is often asked, I think, in the theory papers or even in your viva, is the management of an absent pulse, okay? Now, I think there are two different sides to it. One is where you have an absent pulse with loss of circulation, okay? So that will be a white pulseless hand, or and the other is a pink pulseless hand. Okay, now, and you need to differentiate the two because the management is very different in terms of whether you will need to do any vascular reconstruction or not. So the general consensus, okay, this is not something which everyone accepts, and there are some people who feel that if you can't feel the pulse, you should be exploring the vessel and doing something. But by and large, the consensus today is that if you can't feel the pulse, you need to do an urgent reduction, okay? Now, usually in a lot of these cases, once you reduce the fracture, because the vessel is being kinked up by the fracture, especially when the arm is in extension, this will Once you reduce the fracture, automatically the circulation and the pulse is restored. But once you reduced it, you still don't have a pulse, what do you do? Now, I think if the circulation is okay, the capillary return is okay, your oximetry is okay, and the finger circulation is okay, and the movements of the fingers, etc., were okay, then I think it's reasonable to observe and not do anything. Okay. However, these are patients you should admit overnight and watch them for the next 24 hours to make sure that things do not deteriorate. A Doppler may help you detect a pulse in some of these. Okay, now if it is a pulseless, non-viable hand, that means there is no circulation, there is no capillary return, you can't feel it on Doppler, and your pulse oximetry's readings are way low, then I think it's different and you need to explore the vessel. Whether you need to do an arteriogram, most people nowadays tend to get an arteriogram, but it's not really necessary, because in these injuries, you know where the vascular injury will be. And you need to explore it right there, right where the fracture is, and that's where the vascular injury will be. Okay, so doing an arteriogram in a small child at sort of middle of the night, etc., is quite unnecessary. It's more important to go ahead and do the vascular exploration and repair, reconstruction if required. What about open reduction? Again, we mentioned that it should not be needed most of the times. I think 95% of the times, or even more, in a fresh fracture, you should be able to get a closed reduction. However, if you need to do an open reduction, now there sort of, how do you approach it? I think you could do it medial or lateral, but today there's a, especially for the extension type of fracture, because the proximal fragment comes out anteriorly, making an anterior transverse incision appears to be a very nice way of doing it. Of course, you have to be familiar with the anatomy. Okay, so you go anteriorly, get it reduced, and put your K-wires. Now, you can have problems where it's not reduced, or there's a neurovascular injury by the fracture, compartment syndromes, cubitus varus deformity, and also be aware of iatrogenic nerve injury. Okay, so this is why documentation becomes important. You need to make sure that any nerve injury is documented prior to your reduction or manipulation, so that you don't get blamed for any injury that was there from before. And also, you know that if the nerve injury has been caused during your manipulation, there may be a risk of the nerve being entrapped in the fracture fragment, and you might need to explore it. So it's critical to document any nerve injury prior to your manipulation. Okay. Compartment syndrome, cubitus varus, nerve injuries, etc. Usually a closed nerve injury which you've discovered prior to your manipulation will not need exploration. There are some exceptions, but usually would not. If it is along with a vascular injury, that's a different situation. And most of these would recover. Okay. I think compartment syndrome is something that you really have to be aware of. It's essentially a clinical diagnosis, pain which is out of proportion to what you expect. Very often it's due to a tight cast or tight bandages, and that's something you need to avoid. And if there is any doubt, if you have sort of access to measurement of pressure, that's a good thing. But like I said, it's more of a clinical diagnosis, and where there's doubt, you should be ready to decompress the compartment. Okay. So there's an example of a patient who presented late to us, almost on the third day. And by the time he came to us, he had almost no movement in his fingers. You can see the swelling, really tense compartments. And It was in that time where you were not sure whether you should be doing anything or not. But if the compartment is tense, I think even at this stage, after 24 to 48 hours, in a child, it's worth going in and decompressing it. You can see there was some dead muscle, which we had to excise, but we went ahead and decompressed all the muscles. So you need to do individual muscles in these late cases so that the epimysium is not tightened on the muscle. You need to excise any muscle that's dead. You need to make sure all the nerves are released. And he recovered and gradually... anything if they come late. Obviously, if they come in the first 24 hours and you have an established compartment syndrome, you need to decompress. Once they come later, you need to go by clinical findings, how tense the forearm is, and make your decision based on that. Cubitus varus, again, like I said, in the medially displaced fractures, there's usually an angulation as well as a rotation. And if the Bowman's angle, now Bowman's angle is looked at in two different ways. Some people call it 10 degrees and some people call it 80 degrees. So if it is beyond what is the normal thing, you would need to not accept it and correct it. Otherwise, you will need an osteotomy later. Some variations, we talked about the flexion type of fracture. So you can see in this, distal fragment is displaced anteriorly. And here, you have to be careful because if you try to pin it in extension, you'll find that it is displaced more. So you would give traction, you'd get the mediolateral reduction, but then you would try to pin it in a relatively extended position. Watch the lateral view to make sure that the distal fragment is not flexed up and then put in your pins. Here's a case we had just recently, which was again another variant, because you can see there's an intercondylar fracture here. Okay, you see the lateral, that the medial side is grossly displaced, and this child, 7-year-old child, 10-year-old child, also had an ulnar nerve palsy. Okay, now because of the fracture type and the ulnar nerve involvement, we decided to do a medial sort of approach. You can see here also the distal fragment on the lateral view is displaced anteriorly. So it's a variant of the flexion type, but also with an intercondylar element. So we explored the nerve. It was stretched but not damaged. So we released the nerve, and through this rent, which is where the fracture was, we did a closed open reduction and did a cross wiring here, because here we were right there on the ulnar side, so we could wire it. And you can see we've been able to get a good reduction. And you don't need to flex up the elbow. You keep it in a semi-extended position. And that's the position it was kept in, immobilized in. Now, in the very young child, you have to watch out for this transcondylar fracture, okay? Especially less than 1 year old. And you, because the trochlea is not visible at this time, it will give you the appearance of a dislocation. But the elbow dislocation is usually a posterolateral displacement, and these physial injuries, which is a transphysial injury in the small child, usually goes on the medial side. So the displacement is usually medial rather than lateral. Okay, so that is the difference between a dislocation and a transphysial injury. The other thing that you'll find is that the radial head lines up with the capitellum, okay? So that will tell you that it's not a dislocation, but a transphysial injury. So these would need to be reduced and again fixed with K-wires. Even in a small child, you can use very thin K-wires. If they come late, then it's probably because they heal very quickly, okay? So within a week or 10 days, it would have healed, and then it becomes more difficult. And there is a feeling that in these really small children, there is an element of remodeling there. This is, so the general kind of consensus is not to interfere after about 7 days, to leave it and allow mobilization. And if there's a deformity, you would correct it later. Okay. But beware of it. Beware that it could be mistaken for a dislocation or missed altogether. Okay. So I think in conclusion, remember that these supracondylar fractures is a common fracture in children. There are significant potential for complications. You need to evaluate them carefully and have a clear protocol for their management. Okay, most of them can be managed by closed reduction and percutaneous pinning, but some of them may need open reduction. Watch out for neurological injuries, vascular injuries, and compartment syndromes, which are the serious early complications. And the late problem is usually a cubitus varus. You can get stiffness, but that is more because of other reasons than either a lot of manipulation, myositis, or too vigorous physiotherapy that they end up stiff. Otherwise, most of these will get back a good range of motion. Thank you. Okay, so any questions?
DNBs?
Sir, good evening, sir. Sir, cast duration, if we do closed reduction without pinning, and if we do closed reduction with the pinning, then what is the duration of the cast, sir?
By and large, most of these fractures will heal in 3 weeks. Okay?
Okay.
So I think 3 weeks is the kind of time that most people will keep it in. I think if you keep it, it's because we leave the wires outside, for some reason, if you leave it for more than 3 or 4 weeks, you tend to get problems with pin track infections. Okay?
Yes, sir.
And usually it's healed and will not displace after 3 weeks. Okay? So it's usually okay to remove the cast, start mobilization at 3 weeks.
And
very different for a lateral condyle fracture. Okay? For a lateral condyle fracture, sometimes it takes longer. You may need to keep the wires and cast for 6 weeks or even 2 months. Okay.
Okay, sir. And wires could also be removed at 3 weeks.
Yeah, because
normally
you want to mobilize the child. Okay, and these wires are outside. If you put the wires in for some reason, okay, so yes, in a late case you're doing open reduction, then you can keep the wires inside the skin. Then there's no rush to remove it. But if they are outside, I think before you start mobilizing them, you should remove them.
Sir, okay. What is
the... And sir, any supination, pronation, sir, which... Arm should be kept in supination or pronation.
Yeah. So, how does pronation and supination help? It is based on closing the hinge, okay? So generally, if the fracture is displaced medially, okay, so you look at the fracture displacement, okay? Majority of them are posterior and medial, okay? And those you would usually pronate first once you reduce them, okay? And that usually closes the gap on the fracture on the medial side. Okay, because if you can imagine that the fracture is displaced posteriorly and medially, which periosteum is going to be intact? The posterior and medial. Okay?
Yes, sir.
When you pronate it, you are stretching the periosteum on the medial side. Okay?
Yes, sir.
On the other side, if it is a posterior and lateral displacement, what is recommended is that you would first do it in supination. But this is not a rule. Okay, this is, so once you do that, suppose you are pronating it and you're finding it that is not the best position, then try supinating it and see. Okay? You understand? But by and large, generally, for the medial displaced one, you will pronate, and for the lateral displaced one, you will supinate in the cast. Okay?
This is the reduction method, and while putting cast or slab, sir, pronation for the posterior medial
reduction. Even in reduction, because it also closes, helps closing the gap. Okay, so if you are closing the gap in that position, you want to immobilize in that position. Once you put the wires, it's not so important. Okay?
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
If you're fixing it, then it after, so you hold it there, keep it in the reduced position. Once you put your wires, then it doesn't matter.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Okay.
And sir, one more question, sir. What is the point of pin, sir?
Sorry?
Entry point of K wire, sir.
Entry point of
Hello?
K wire. Yeah. So entry point of K wires, you need to be in the distal fragment. Okay. So that's what you need to watch out for, that you are in the lateral condyle in the distal fragment, because in the low fracture, there's sometimes a tendency to go through the fracture when you're putting your wires. Okay. Now.
Yes, sir.
Where it is, so you want to ideally be lateral to the olecranon fossa in your entry point, okay?
Okay, sir.
And you would put the wires in a way that they diverge from each other from, when you're putting them on the lateral side, okay? So one wire would go slightly higher and one wire would go lower. Usually, it will, one of the lower wire will go through the olecranon fossa and hit the two cortices in the olecranon fossa as well. So it becomes almost like a four cortex wire. Okay?
Four cortex, sir. Yes, sir.
When you're putting cross wires, that's different. Okay? Ideally, you should not cross your wires at the fracture site. Okay?
Yes, sir.
Okay, your wires should cross more proximal to the fracture site. Because if your both your wires are crossing at the fracture site, your chances of getting some rotational instability is higher. Okay?
Yes.
Because you have only one point in the middle that is going is through the fracture. Okay? Any?
Yes, sir.
Any other question?
Sir, in a patient presenting with nerve palsy at the time of diagnosis and we manage it with close reduction, what is the expected time that we wait before we reach to the conclusion that the nerve has to be explored?
Okay, so I think this is, there's no, again, like I said, no fixed rules. Generally, if you have, if you've documented the nerve injury pre-reduction, okay, so the consensus is to manage them conservatively, okay? But there are some exceptions, okay? So if you have a vascular injury with a nerve injury, then obviously you're going to explore the vessel and you're going to also try and repair the nerve if it is explore the nerve at the same time, okay?
Right.
So this combination of vessel injury and median nerve injury is not uncommon. Okay, so that's... But if you're treating them closed, usually around 6 to 8 weeks is the time you will then do a nerve conduction study to see if there, what the nerve potentials are, is there any signs of recovery. By and large, you wait for 3 to 4 months at least to, if you're managing them expectantly, to look for any signs of recovery. Okay, you look at tinel sign, various things, okay? But after, if there is no sign, then you have to make a decision. Now, it doesn't mean it has recovered fully. But if you are seeing that there is a change or there's some improvement, then you can wait longer. But if you find that there's absolutely no improvement at 3 to 4 months, then it makes sense to explore the nerve. Okay, so there are instances of the nerve being actually caught in the fracture site. We had one patient, believe it or not, who came to us late with a nerve injury, with a radial nerve, and it was actually in the callus. Okay, this is many, many, unfortunately, we couldn't get photographs. This was some years ago. When we explored the nerve, it was actually trapped in the callus of the fracture.
Sir, what is the usual pin size when we are using it for 5 to 7 years age group, sir?
So it varies. So you can use one really small child, you will use 1.6, slightly older child 1.8, and if they are around 10-12, then you might use one even a 2 millimeter wire. Okay, but generally thin wires. Yeah.
Just one theoretical question, sir. When we say it is type 1 fracture extension type and type 1 fracture flexion type, so how we can differentiate these two, sir? Because
see, type 1 fracture flexion type, you don't really see, okay?
Yes, sir.
That's like, I don't think I've seen one in my life. So I won't know.
Sir, you told because that anterior fat pad and posterior fat pad both get stiffened.
It doesn't matter if it's flexion type or extension type because it's an undisclosed. We're not manipulating that.
Okay.
We're not going to fix that.
Okay. Sir.
Sorry, what were you saying?
Sir, I was asking that it is anterior fat pad. Yeah. Is usual that this is a new.
There normally also. Okay. But. Okay. A very small thing, but if it is displaced up and this thing, then you know that it may be a hematosis in the joint. Okay. Well, the posterior is not there normally. If you see the posterior fat pad in sign, that means there is some hematosis there.
Sir, if a fracture is displaced posterior medially, without a vascular injury, and we are like trying to reduce it by an open reduction, so we follow a medial approach, and likewise for posterior lateral.
So this is again. So there is no fixed rule on this. Okay. The idea is that today you should not have to do open reduction in fresh fractures in say 95% of the cases. If you have to, it depends on the. On your familiarity, you can do it from the lateral side, you can do it from the medial side. The medial scar is usually less obvious, okay? And you can do it from the anterior side, okay? The anterior side, if you have to explore the vessel, then the anterior side makes sense. If you do it on the skin crease on the anterior side, today that is for the sort of, so, there are two things. One is that if you are having to do an open reduction, the chances are that it's a significantly displaced fracture. Okay?
Right, sir.
Yeah? And usually
yes, sir.
Something is stopping your reduction. So now there are various methods, techniques where you can use joysticks like, there are people who've used the suction tip, cannula tip into the fracture area. Or to push on it, or to make a small nick, put a small wire or lever and lever the fracture out. And you can even use the Kapanji technique. We've done it once. I can't find the pictures of that. I was looking for that where we actually had to put our wire through the fracture, use that to reduce the fracture, and then pass it into the proximal fragment. Okay, so that's another way you can do it. So there are many open techniques. But finally, if nothing works, don't be worried about opening it and doing it. Okay.
Sir, Jaswinder this side. Good evening. What would be an indication of doing a tricep splitting approach? I mean, I know it causes a lot of stiffness, but there are some papers they say. They say that they prefer a tricep splitting approach than others.
For what?
For open reduction. Like for the intercondylar, especially, I mean, the case like we had day before yesterday.
Tricep splitting doesn't make sense to me.
That is a posterior approach.
So if you can use a posterior approach, but you can use something like a trap or something like that in that case, yeah. For a paratricipital approach rather than a tricep splitting approach. Okay.
Right.
But again, I mean it's a question of what you are comfortable with. I mean the VY I would not use. So so-called Campbell, where you divide the triceps. So for fresh fractures and all, it doesn't make sense. I mean, if you're doing an arthrolysis or something, some people would use that. But even there, we nowadays hardly ever use it. So,
can we say that it is kind of a contraindication for a supracondylar fracture? Is it?
So you can say that if you like. I don't know. I think. What is a contraindication?
The posterior approach.
The posterior approach.
The tricep splitting, I'm asking. For a supracondylar open adult. Okay, right. So, that is a contraindication. Some people do use, might be it is just a preference that they are more comfortable.
Exactly. So, it's not a contraindication, but it's not something that.
The other question is for an anterior approach.
Let's put it that way.
What is the approach in the, between what structures we go in an anterior approach? We had an IFIX seminar day before, and one of the speaker, he told that it is quite preferred. The healing is also quite good with a transverse incision.
Yeah.
But what is the exactly?
So if you know your anatomy, you have the biceps tendon, which is prominent there.
Right.
Okay. You have the lacetous fibrosis, and the moment you divide it, you're onto the vessels and the median nerve. Okay. And in these fresh fractures, usually the proximal fragment would have come out through the brachialis into that area. Okay. Right. So you're right on the fracture. Okay. It also gives you access to the vessel if there is a vascular injury. So that's why that has become more or less the preferred approach. But it's not, if you're not comfortable with it, use something you're comfortable with it. If there's an ulnar nerve injury, then I would use an approach which gives me access to the ulnar nerve. If it's a median nerve injury, I'd certainly use the anterior approach. Okay?
Okay, sir. Sir, I want to ask about pink pulseless hand. What is that?
I thought that's what we discussed quite a lot at that point. If it's a pink pulseless hand, but the capillary return is okay. Okay, your function is okay. That means the child is able to move the fingers, etc. There's no neurological problem, and the oximetry, etc., all normal. Okay, which it normally would be if it's a pink pulseless hand. That means the capillary circulation is okay. Then the first thing is, of course, to reduce the fracture. Okay? So because reducing the fracture, you may get the pulse back. Then there's no problem at all. If after that, you still don't get the pulse back, but the capillary return, etc., all okay, you can check the Doppler. Sometimes you can see the waveform in the Doppler. Some people say that's important. But essentially, it's clinical in terms of the finger, capillary return and movements, function. Okay, and if those are okay, your oximetry is okay, I would wait and watch, but admit these patients and observe them over 24 hours so that if there is any problem, you will notice it. Some of these will get back the pulse within 24 hours. Okay, others will not. But if the function is okay, by and large, the consensus today is to leave them and not worry about it too much. However, there is an opposite view to it. So there are some surgeons who feel that you should explore it in this situation and do a reconstruction. So it's not 100%, but by and large, there have been a number of studies which have shown that it is not a major issue. The people who say that you should explore it claim that there will be some minor motor weaknesses of the muscles of the hand. Don't do it. Okay. So there is a group of people who feel, but on the other side, there's been a study which has looked at these patients who've had this sort of vascular reconstructions or repairs in these patients. And 1 year down the line, they found that none of these anastomoses are actually functional. So it's the collaterals which are actually giving the circulation. Okay. But if you have loss of function, there's a white hand, that means there's no pulse, there's no capillary return, there's no oximetry reading, then I think it is essential to revascularize that limb, because then it's a avascular limb which needs vascularity. Yeah?
Sir, even if it is a pink hand with some neural deficit, so in that case it is open procedure, sir?
Okay, so this is a slightly controversial area. I mean, it's usually the median nerve. Suppose you have a pink pulseless hand with a median nerve palsy. There's, again, these are not absolute truths, but some people feel that that is an indication that there is a definite vascular injury and you should explore the vessel. Okay? Again, sir, yeah.
Sir, for reduction, it is in emergency or in OT?
Yes. So I think what happens, if you have a patient who comes to you with the arm fully extended, okay, so I think this was, if you listen to that iFix talk by David Skaggs, okay, I mean, he also mentioned it, but this is basic common sense. You will find that in an extension type of injury, the vessel is going to be kinked. Okay, so you don't want to leave it in that position. You would gently flex up the elbow and put it in a slab. Now, as long as there is no neurovascular injury, you can, rather than do it in the middle of the night, do it next morning with all your proper stuff there. Okay, but if there is any doubt about vascularity, compartment syndrome, etc., then you should not wait. Then even if it's the middle of the night, you have to do it.
Okay. So, orthopedic emergency and orthopedic urgency. That thing, the difference, I want to know. Means when we are doing it planned way on next day.
Again, like a fracture neck femur, okay? At one time, people used to think it's an orthopedic emergency. Today, people will say rather than you're better off not doing it in the middle of the night where you have inadequate staff, not the best anesthesia, and not necessarily the most competent team. So it makes sense to do it first thing next morning, then do it in the middle of the night. Even open fractures, okay? So at one time there was this 6-hour rule that you had to go in and debride within 6 hours. But what they found is that it makes more sense to do it when you have experienced surgeon, experienced anesthesia, the patient is properly worked up, the C-arm technician is the correct person. All these things make a difference to the eventual outcome of the patient. And they found that it's better to wait rather than do it in the middle of the night. But again, if there's a lot of contamination, if there's compartment syndrome, if there's vascular injury, you can't wait. Okay? So similarly, so those are the differences between an emergency, urgency, and semi-urgency. I mean, you can call it what you like.
Sir, position of elbow in the slab, it is less than 90 degree or more than 90 degree. That is also a little controversial.
What is important?
That vascularity.
Okay.
And reduction.
So if you are not pinning them. Okay, now, if you're doing closed reduction without pinning, then unless you flex up the elbow to, some people say 100, some people say 110, some people even say 120, the posterior interosseous and the triceps will not splint the fracture adequately to maintain your reduction. Okay? So then you have to keep it in that position. But in that position, if there's a lot of swelling, firstly, it's difficult and you're at risk of compromising the circulation or risking compartment syndrome, etc. So once you put the vials, then it should be stable enough for you to put it in a position of comfort. Now, if you keep it straight, it's difficult for the child, okay? Because it makes sense to be in around 80, 90 degrees of flexion. Then you can put it in a sling, etc. afterwards. So you would put it in a position that you're comfortable about the swelling and the circulation. So flex it to 80, 90, where you can then keep him in that position without worrying about changing the cast or something like that. Okay.
And so then we are putting the...
Once you've done the closed reduction, whatever, etc., usually the swelling also reduces significantly.
Sir, when we are putting the medial pincer, you explained that like mini open procedure by seeing the ulnar nerve. And what are the other precautions we should take?
So the way we do it is not always looking for the nerve, but feeling for it where possible. So there are two or three important things. One is, so once you put your lateral pins in, you don't need to hold it flexed up fully, okay? You are able to extend it a bit. So that makes it a little easier for you. Second thing is, the medial epicondyle is cartilage, okay? So you make a small nick, introduce the wire into the medial epicondyle before you start drilling. Okay, the risk is of the nerve getting caught up in your wire. Now, if you're already inside bone, then the chances of it getting caught up in the wire, especially if you pull down on the skin here and enter slightly anteriorly, the chances are the nerve will be behind once you extend. When you flex up the elbow, that is in a fully flexed position, it becomes more risky. Yeah?
While putting the medial pincer, do we are taking some precaution for radial nerve also? Because on lateral side, where it goes.
Radial nerve becomes important when you're doing what you call, you've heard of the dog and spin. What is that?
Trochens. Procedure there, spin, sir. I think lateral cross spinning is called Drogon spin.
No, cross. So where you enter, instead of using it from the medial epicondyle, you start higher up on the lateral side and go towards the medial epicondyle. Okay, so you can do a cross wire, but both the entry is lateral, one distal, one proximal. Okay, so there you have to be careful of the radial nerve. Okay, when you're putting your lateral pin, you have to be careful when you go across the medial side, the proximal fragment cortex, that you're not too far out on the anteromedial side. Okay, because the vessel may be there, and we have one patient who had who came later with a pseudoaneurysm of the brachial artery. Okay, so that's something you have to be careful of. Because when you do the AP lateral, it may be deceptive as to how far out the wire is, because it's in an oblique plane. It may be more out than you think it is just looking at AP and lateral X-ray. And that's why it's important when you are doing your fixation to check it in all the views. Okay, so AP lateral and oblique views, not just to look at the pillars, but also to look at how far your wires are out. Okay.
Sir, just one question related to like when we are putting the elastic nails, sir, in that case, you say you reach at the fracture site, then progress both the titanium nail. In that way, sir, I have read in few papers, they have given that you reach the K wire at fracture site, then progress. Is it like that, or we can put it one by one, sir?
In children, we tend to put them one by one, yeah?
Okay.
Not like elastic nailing for the inner. Elastic nailing is different when you're doing elastic nailing for a femur or tibia. Yes, you try to get to the fracture site because you want the wires to cross this. Okay, this is totally different. And the principle is totally different. There you are looking at three-point fixation. Here you're
going. Manipulation, sir. So, what is the end point of manipulation so that we should decide that now we can open when it is not getting released?
That is, I mean, you, it's, when you decide, it's, you've tried hard long enough, yeah? I mean, there's no fixed rule. You can say you try once or twice or three times, but generally, if you can't get it reduced, because it's not just reducing, you have to pass your wires also. Sometimes it looks reduced, but when you're passing your wires, it's not, it's out of place. So there's no rule key. You try. It's not like a neck femur where you reduce and then start your fixation or you plan to do open reduction. Huh? Sometimes you are working on it while you're reducing it, etc. Okay. So there you reduce it, put it on the table, and then plan, start your draping and thing. So there they say you try twice, after that don't try to open it. Here it's a little different. And avascularity is not an issue. Or not such a major issue.
Yes. So I think.
Okay, so I think it's already. Yes. Yeah.
One question, sir. From the radial nerve injury during close reduction of humeral shaft fracture, sir.
What about it?
And then management, sir, immediate exploration or delayed?
Okay, so this is again a little controversial. I think by and large, consensus is that it happens during manipulation, you should explore, okay?
Okay, sir.
So I think for your DNB exam, that would be the correct answer. Although there have been a couple of studies which have looked at it and not found that much difference. Yeah?
Yes, sir. That's why I'm asking. Okay, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Until next week or whatever. Okay. Bye, Ashok.
Bye, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, sir.